Mr. Lincoln Snyder. Mr. Snyder previously served as the Executive Director of Catholic Schools at the Diocese of Sacramento. Mr. Snyder worked as a teacher, board member, and board chair for the Palisado Christian Brothers. He is a graduate of Christian Brothers High School, the Georgetown University Scholar of Foreign Service, and St. Mary's University of Minnesota. In addition to his role as President and CEO of NCAA, Mr. Snyder also serves as the Vice Chair of CAPE. Welcome, President Lincoln Snyder.
Thank you so much. And good morning, New Orleans. Great to be here. On behalf of Bishop Kakanis, the NCEA Board of Directors, and the entire NCEA team, it is my honor to welcome you to the city of New Orleans. This city plays an outsized role in our nation's cultural heritage, and Catholic education is an important part of its fabric. I would like to thank our hosts, Archbishop Gregory Michael Amond, Superintendent Dr. Raynell Houston, Deputy Superintendent Martha Mundine, the school's office, the volunteers, the staff, our partners, all those whose extra effort makes this return to gathering in person possible. In the coming days, you will enjoy worship, music, food, all done in the joy of Easter week and in dedication to our shared mission of bringing our students to Jesus Christ. And when your charism as an organization is bringing people together, there is nothing better than after a two-year journey we've all been on together than be able to say that we're back. So as they say in New Orleans, laissez le bon temps rouler, let the good times roll. And what a long, strange trip it's been to bring us to today. In my first words as your new president this past July, I talked about heroes and growth, and I'd like to return to those themes for a moment. You, our Catholic school educators, have truly led us on a hero's journey these past 2 years. We recognized several of those heroes last night at our awards dinner. People like Leticia Oseguera of Mater Dei Juan Diego Academy in San Diego, educating the next generation of faith-filled, bilingual, global leaders. Or Sister of St. Francis, Thomas Ann Quinn, who has offered 67 years service to Catholic schools as a teacher, principal, and most recently as liturgical director at Our Lady of Mount Carmel School in Doylestown, and she's still going strong. They and over 100,000 other Catholic educators answered the call to serve students during this pandemic in person, wherever possible and as early as possible, despite the stress and the risk and the challenges, because it was best for the kids. And now, as we move from pandemic to endemic, and we reach the end of this two-year journey, we take stock of our quest. The real gift of the hero's journey is the special knowledge he or she brings back to the community on the completion of the quest. What is that special knowledge? I would like to offer two thoughts. One, a reflection on our mission, and the other, a call to action. A reflection. These years have been hard on all of us, physically and emotionally exhausting, lasting longer than we could have imagined. How does this relate to our mission? All Catholic schools endeavor to transform our young into servant leaders in Christ. But it's not just the kids who are transformed. We all know that kids learn more from what we do than what we say. You heard the call to servant leadership in his name, and you dug deep to deliver what your students and communities really needed. What if all of these additional months of Delta and Omicron and all of the stress and death and conflict, and your unflinching witness in the face of all of that, is what really makes that lesson stick for our students? Kids know what it takes to be a servant leader in Christ. They've seen one. You. And to my second point, I know that you've helped your students grow as learners too. I've seen the data, and that's our call to action. Catholic schools did better than anyone in preventing learning loss during COVID. Our students kept growing nearly at the rate we would have anticipated if there had been no COVID. Catholic schools led the way. Not that we don't have our work cut out for us. As we look to help our students coming out of this pandemic, there is no doubt we need to focus on the essentials and accelerate learning in faith and core academic skills, especially for our youngest learners. The gaps for this generation of students are real, but for our kids, thanks to your heroic efforts, getting them to the point in their growth as believers and as scholars that it's almost like this pandemic never happened is within our grasp. Think about that. It's remarkable. And as a Catholic school parent, let me say thank you. But in that same data is our call to action. As I look at the overall student numbers, it makes me proud as a Catholic and a little bit terrified as an American. There is a generation of kids who will never recover all those learning losses unless we as a country take action. So what is our role in that? No one is better prepared to model the way forward in that same spirit of servant leadership in Christ than we are. I would argue it's our duty. We showed that it was possible to operate schools safely and effectively in a pandemic and limit the harm to our kids. Your hard work and sacrifice and success during COVID has led to record growth in enrollment and given us momentum of a kind that we only see once in a generation. Now, we must show that we can help this generation of students overcome and achieve and grow. And as we look to take on that quest, the collective wisdom we need to do so is right here in this room. As your association, it is our job to connect you to the people and resources you need to have excellent Catholic schools. We've got data, we provide advocacy, we offer world-class professional development and tools to better pass on the faith. But most importantly, we connect you to each other. So please take a moment to look to your right and look to your left. You're looking at a hero. Thank you. And heroes, our time to act is now. As we look to seize the day and help our kids grow and help our schools grow, use this opportunity to make new friends and share and learn and work together so that we can help each other do just that. Enjoy this convention. Take in our remarkable keynote. Learn from the 96 world-class PD sessions on offer. And let our shared faith inspire you as we come together daily for the Holy Eucharist. Check out the Partner Pavilion and learn about how they can support you and your community. But most importantly, learn from the heroes around you as we come together in community and in shared mission, preparing our young in a spirit of excellence for this world and the next. It's an honor to be in your presence, and thank you for the chance to serve you. Our professional and spiritual growth begin this morning with our first keynote address. This morning, we have the honor of welcoming Father Tony Ricard to the main stage. Father Tony is a Catholic priest for the Archdiocese of New Orleans, the pastor of St. Gabriel the Archangel Parish, and the campus minister at St. Augustine High School in New Orleans. He has given keynote addresses, retreats, revivals, and youth talks across the nation. He is a native of New Orleans and a proud graduate of St. Augustine High School. He holds a Bachelor of Science degree in elementary education from Loyola University in New Orleans, a Master of Theology degree from Xavier University of Louisiana's Institute for Black Catholic Studies, and a Master of Divinity degree from Notre Dame Seminary. It has been a joy to learn from Father Tony and his contributions to the NCEA podcast and Momentum magazine. He has also authored several books on the topic of ministry to our youth. Father Tony will address the topic, Have You Seen Him? Each day we are given the chance to encounter the Lord. How many times has Jesus Christ tried to visit us and we miss seeing him for who he really was? As teachers and leaders in Catholic schools, it is our call to search for Christ in the least expected places. So it is with great enthusiasm that I welcome Father Tony Ricard as this morning's keynote speaker at NCEA 2022 convention. Father Tony.
Couldn't hear nobody pray way down yonder by myself. I couldn't hear nobody pray. You know, there once was a time in the very space where you now sit, where there were folks who were brought into the Americas because someone thought that they could enslave them. A lot of times when you think about it, you wonder, what could make somebody think that they could hold somebody in bondage? But what was crazy was the fact that in addition to trying to enslave doctors and lawyers and craftsmen and you know, farmers and hunters and cooks and nurses, they thought that even in shackling their body, they could somehow shackle their mind too, and their spirit. You know, there was a time when folk thought that they could tell other people how they were supposed to pray. Can you imagine trying to tell somebody how they're supposed to pray? Talk about the unmitigated gall. That not only could you tell somebody how they're supposed to talk to God, but even more, they thought they could tell God how he was supposed to listen. But you know, my ancestors of African descent, they knew that God would listen. But they also knew that if they prayed the way their spirit said to pray, they could somehow be beaten or even killed for praising God. So what they would do is they would sneak off late at night into a clearing deep in the woods. They would call it a hush harbor or an old camp meeting. And when they would get deep into the woods, they'd have a chance to pray like their spirit said to pray. Now, when they would get out in the clearing, they would take a big kettle pot and they would flip it upside down, because what they believed was whatever did not hit the ears of God would fall into that pot and be trapped by Mother Earth. But you see, they still were afraid, because as they were singing and dancing and shouting and preaching, they were afraid that somehow they would be heard at the big house and could get in trouble for having church. So they would leave one person at the mansion. And that person's job was to walk around the mansion all night long and listen. Their official title was the listener. And what they would listen is to make sure that nothing that was being done out in the woods was being heard at the mansion. But in the morning when they would get up, they would have to let everybody know that, you know, nothing was wrong with last night. So the way they would do it is they couldn't stand on the porch and say, "Everybody, we had church last night and it was good." So they would have to do it in a cold. And they would begin to sing. And while they were singing, you know, the master might be up on the porch rocking in his chair, drinking a mint julep or something. And they would sing and send out a code that would tell everybody, everything gonna be all right. So the listener would say, "Couldn't hear nobody pray. Couldn't hear nobody pray. Way down yonder by myself, I couldn't hear nobody pray." Well, y'all know, when we think about Catholic education in the United States of America, even to this day, there are folk who still want to tell us how we're supposed to pray. There are folk who think that because we are Roman Catholics, that somehow maybe we don't know the same Jesus that they know. And I know that y'all came expecting to have a keynote presentation. But if it's all right with y'all, we about to have an old camp meeting. We're about to spend some time praising God. Because you see, on May 27, 1995, I was blessed to walk into the St. Francis Cabrini Church. And it was at that church that I literally laid myself out on the floor and promised God that I would preach and teach like he taught me. And so I can tell you that I'm excited to be here today. I know that you know, it's a blessing to be with y'all. And I know right now some of you are still wondering, who is this guy and where did he come from? But I promise you, you are so honored to be in my presence. You have no idea. When I'm done, you're going to be Googling your mama. Girl, I'm telling you, you have no idea. Because what you're about to get is truly me. Authentically Black and Catholic and excited to be a part of the Catholic education in our nation. I can tell you that for me, my whole foundation is being a teacher. My whole foundation of who I am. Before I went to the seminary, I was a New Orleans public school teacher. My undergraduate degree is elementary education, and I'm a certified 1-8 school teacher. So if this priesthood thing don't work out, I'm going back to the classroom. And I got my certificate before they did all them renewal things. I got the grandfather clause. So I'm just telling my archbishop, he might need to put a signing bonus on the table, because I can make a lot of money right now with 30-something years experience teaching, certifications, couple master's degrees. Y'all know y'all pay big for that. I'm just saying. But I can tell you that for me, the joy is just to be here with you, to say to you, thank you for what you do. Because you see, when I made my vow, I promised God that I would bring the gifts to the table, but I didn't want to bring it by myself. Because see, y'all need to know that the greatest joy for me is to have others following that footstep. The greatest joy for me is to know that when I made my vow, it was so that others could make their vows too. Which is why it is my privilege to share with you the gift of St. Augustine High School in New Orleans. My campus ministry program. We don't really have a choir because we just brothers that travel the nation praying together. Mr. Bukri, tell them about them vows.
Done made my vow to the Lord, and I never will turn back. I shall go to see what then open my mouth to the Lord, and I never will turn back. I will go, I shall go to see what the end will be. Sometimes I'm up, sometimes I'm down.
See what the end will be.
But I know my soul is still heavenly bound.
See what the end will be.
And if you get there before I do,
see what the end will be.
Be sure to tell them I'm coming too.
See what the end will be.
Then made my vow to the Lord, and I never will turn back. I will go, I shall go to see what
the end will be.
Then open my mouth to the Lord, and I never, 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 never will turn back. I will go, I shall go to see what the end will be. Then made my vow to the Lord. Then made my vow to the Lord,
and
made my vow to the Lord to see what
the end will be.
And made my vow to the Lord, and made my vow to the Lord, and made my vow to the Lord to see what the end will be. One more time, make it strong. And made my vow, and made my vow to the Lord, and made my vow to the Lord, and made my vow to the Lord
to see what the end will be.
And made my vow to the Lord, and I never will turn back. I will go, I shall go, I will go,
I shall go,
I will go,
I will go,
I shall go,
I shall go,
to see what
the end will be.
Come on. You know, it's always such a blessing, you know, when I get a chance to come out to be with y'all. And I know that sometimes y'all don't even understand that. I know I made my vow, and my vow is what's going to get me into that kingdom of heaven if I live it according to the will of God. But y'all got to know why you should be so honored to be with me. Because see, the day is coming when I'm going to be a saint. Saint Tony of New Orleans, patron of saint of parents with disgruntled children. But they call me now thinking I can solve their problems. So you know if they think I'm up in heaven, they're going to be calling me. In fact, let me do a little room check. If you are planning on being a saint one day, raise your hand. Let me see. They got a couple people didn't raise their hands. Let me share with you the options. In the Catholic Church, after death, we only believe in two places. Those who live with God in heaven, we call what?
Saints.
The rest burn in hell. So I know I'm planning, you know, I saw people didn't raise their hands. I don't have holy water, but I will bless my mouth and spit on people. I'm just saying, hey, Jesus healed the blind with spit. I can do it. I'm just saying, but like, I'm planning on being the same because I've seen miracles happen right before my eyes. Because the other day, I was in church getting ready for mass, and one of my altar servers ran in. He's like, "Father, Father, Father!" I'm like, "What?" He's like, "Tell me I gotta tell you what I saw." I said, "Boy, what did you see?" He said, "I saw this man come in church, and he was walking with crutches, and he walked up to the holy water, and he took some holy water and he rubbed it on his leg. Then he took his crutch and he threw it in the air. Then he took some more holy water, rubbed it on his other leg, took his other crutch, and he threw it in the air." I said, "Baby, that's a miracle. Where that man at?" He said, "Flat on the floor, right by the holy water." I don't make them up. I just repeat them. Because the other day, I was walking down the street, and I saw this pack of boys all standing around this dog. And every time I looked at them, they started giggling. And I'm thinking, them little boys are about to hurt the dog. So I walked up, I was like, "Excuse me, gentlemen, but I know you're not going to hurt that dog." And the boy looked up and said, no, Father, we love the dog. And we decided whoever could tell the biggest lie could have the dog. So one little boy raised his hand. He said, "My daddy is George Bush. I can go anywhere in Texas I want to." They're like, nah. Another boy raised his hand. He said, "Well, my daddy is Barack Obama. I can go anywhere in the country I want to." They're like, nah. Another boy raised his hand. He said, "Well, my daddy is Bill Clinton." you never know, but I'm like, no, nah. So I was like, "Excuse me, gentlemen, but don't you know that lying is a sin? It says it right there in the Bible. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor." That means you're not supposed to lie. When I was your age, I never told a lie. Little boy looked up and said, "Give him the dog." Well, needless to say, I did end up with a nice dog, but that's another story. Y'all got to know that for about 12 and a half years of my life, I lived with one of the most gorgeous dogs on the face of this earth. She weighed 121 pounds. She was a Rottweiler named Pepper. And Pepper was the love of my life. And people were like, well, a Rottweiler? Why would the priest get a Rottweiler? Y'all don't live in my neighborhood. If you lived in my neighborhood, you either need to get a Rottweiler or a pistol. I got both. I'm just saying, they're like, Second Amendment, deal with it. I'm just saying, they're like, so, you know, my Rottweiler was a queen. Like, I loved her so much. She was so spoiled. You couldn't get more spoiled than my Rottweiler. In fact, you know, how many of y'all live with a dog in the house? Raise your hand. Do y'all have to deal with people coming to your house, sitting on the sofa and saying, oh, I don't like this. We get dog hair on me. Pepper did not invite you. So if you don't want to sit where Pepper sit, don't come to Pepper house. And but she was the love of my life. In fact, during Hurricane Katrina, my parish had about 6.5 feet of water on the blocks. So that meant that for my rectory, the whole first floor flooded. So when we came back after Katrina, we had to restore everything. So when I redid the den, instead of buying one sofa, I bought two sofas. One for me, one for the Rottweiler. And then, you know, because she grew up in the neighborhood, you know, everybody knew her. Believe it or not, there were kids who were knocking on the door and asking Pepper come out to play. They loved her. And, you know, even if she would sneak out like the side gate or something, you know, in most places, if you got a Rottweiler roaming the streets, no collar, most people would get nervous. One time, my doorbell rang. It was one of the little six-year-olds. He's like, Pweecha. I'm like, what? He said, Pepper got out. And then there was another six-year-old with a Rottweiler in a headlock bringing her right back to the house. But you know, Pepper and I, every now and then we would take walks in the neighborhood. And, you know, people say, like you weren't scared to walk in the neighborhood. It was one of the toughest neighborhoods in the city of New Orleans. But I really wasn't scared because, you know, I had been there for over 12 years, which meant that all them little thuggy thugs on the corner, I baptized them. And they knew if they mess with me, I will unbaptize you. I'll say the prayers back, so hit you with the water, you go straight to hell. I think that's the way it works. Just a little side note, if the priest tells you to go to hell, I think you do. But that's another story. So, you know, they knew not to mess with me. But Pep and I, you know, when we go for our walk right across the street, there was a little park. And normally I could just take her leash off and she'd run around and play with everybody. Well, one day, for whatever reason, Pepper decided that instead of going into the park, she wanted to walk down the street. And I got to tell y'all that, you know, I really wasn't scared to walk in the neighborhood, except for one fact. About a block and a half away from my rectory was a very historic cemetery. Now, I'm going to let y'all in on a little secret. You might catch me in the graveyard in the daytime, but y'all ain't gonna find this brother in no graveyard at night. Because I'm scared. I'm scared of dead people. And people are like, but you're the priest. How are you gonna be scared of dead people? Y'all don't understand. If I walk into the funeral and the air condition blows my mom's dress just a little bit, I'm gone. I'm gonna give you the book and the water. You're gonna finish that yourself. I'm not the one. So I told Pepper, we can go down this street. But if it start getting dark, we got to get back home. So Pep and I started walking down the street. We probably walked about 10 blocks, and then I noticed the sun was going down. So I'm like, girl, we need to go back. So we turned around and started heading back to the rectory. But it looked like the closer we got to the cemetery, the darker it got. Looked like every block we walked, the sun went down a little bit further. By the time I got to the outside wall of the cemetery, it was pitch black like midnight. But I'm not scared though, because I got the Rottweiler. You know, if something come out of the grave, it's going to be bones, a dog like bones. I'm good, right? But when I got close to the wall, I heard a noise coming from inside the graveyard. It was like, boom, boom. But I'm not scared though, because I got the Rottweiler. But I heard it again. It was like, thump, 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 thump. Now I'm starting to get a little scared. Because y'all know in the movies, when you hear the music, you know what's about to happen. And my people are the first to go. So I'm just saying. It was like, thump, 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 thump. When I got to the gate and I looked inside, y'all ain't gonna believe what I saw. I saw a coffin standing up like this. Then I heard the noise. It was like, donk, donk. And the coffin moved. It was like, donk, 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 donk. And the coffin moved again. And when Pepper saw the coffin moving, she took off running down the street. I'm like, you're supposed to protect me. So when I saw the coffin go, donk, 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 I start running after the dog. So the dog start running. I start running. And the coffin started chasing us. It was like, donk, 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 donk. So the dog started going faster. I started going faster. And the coffin started going faster. Like, donk, 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 donk. So I ran in the rectory. And the coffin came inside. It's like, donk, 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 donk. So I ran up the stairs. And the coffin came up the stairs. Like, donk, 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 donk. So I ran in my room. And the coffin came in the room. Like, donk, donk, donk. So I ran in the bathroom. The coffin came in the bathroom. Like, don't, don't, don't. So I opened the medicine cabinet, tried to find something to treat the coffin. Like, Tylenol, I don't know. All I could find was the bottle of Robitussin. So I took the Robitussin and I threw it at the coffin. And the coffin stopped. Right now, they got three ladies looking at each other. I don't get it. Everybody ought to know by now, Robitussin will always stop a coughing attack. Thank y'all. Thank y'all. Thank y'all very much. Thank y'all. Thank y'all. Thank y'all. Thank y'all. I'm here all night. I'm just saying, go ahead. You know, when I think about the blessings that we have and all we bring to the table and the joy we have of being who we are, I can tell you that, you know, being a school teacher laid the foundation of everything that I do. The way I teach, the way I preach, the way I just everything. Because I know that part of the greatest gift I have is I get to follow in the footsteps of the master teacher. And that when we walk this journey of faith, we have to be ever conscious. But you know, when I was in the seminary, I'll never forget that when I was in the seminary, you know, you have to take all these classes. Like, y'all know that you got to take, like, systematic theology. That's how the church operates. Historical theology. They don't teach all the history, but that's another story. And so, but you got to take, you know, moral theology and all these theologies. But do you know that every priest, every deacon also has to take a course called homiletics? It's how to write a homily. And I know y'all have been in church before thinking, this dude ain't never had that class. I'm just saying. But believe it or not, they have to take it. It's required. And when I was in the seminary, the coolest thing was my homiletics teacher was Monsignor Gregory Amen, the Archbishop of New Orleans. And so I always laugh because when he came back to New Orleans after being the bishop of Austin, Texas for about 9 years, and he came to New Orleans to be our archbishop, I told him, I'm so glad you're back home. For me, it was like having, you know, when your Uncle Earl goes away to the military and then he finally come back home after so many years. That's how it felt. I love our archbishop. And I told him at his welcoming celebration with the priest, I said, now, Bishop, I'm so glad you're back. Because you were the rector of the seminary. You taught me homiletics. So if anybody complains, you got to take the blame. And Archbishop Amen looked me in the face. He said, nah, bro, I take the credit. And so you know, in homiletics, it was the coolest thing. He taught us these techniques on how to write a good homily. He said that when you're writing a good homily, you know, the things you ought to do. So like he said on Monday, if you're going to preach that following weekend, read the readings. Priests, deacons, write down. On Monday, if you're going to be preaching that upcoming weekend, read all the readings for that weekend. But don't do anything yet. Just let it sit on your heart. Then on Tuesday, start reading the biblical commentaries. See what some of the big dogs said about it. St. Augustine of Hippo, St. Jerome, St. you know, whoever Collegeville was, them too. Read all that too. And then on Wednesday is the day you start jotting down your ideas. What is coming to you from those readings? Then on Thursday, write your homily out. Now, some priests and deacons, they work from an outline. I can't do that. I have ADHD. And so if I actually went from an outline, we will be in church for a long time. And I'm going to forget half of the stuff I thought I was going to talk about. So I actually write out all of my homilies word for word, which is actually a blessing because 27 years later, they've turned into some really good books available at Booth 117. I'm just saying. And at FatherTony.com. And so you know, like they've actually turned into great books because when I started writing, because I can't preach from an outline, I write out all my talks, all my homilies, word for word. Because I know, first, it's going to keep me on task. Second, if the little boy in the third row of the church is beating his brother with the shoe, I'm not going to forget what I was supposed to do because I'm focusing on the shoe. And I know it'll keep me in the right amount of time. And so on Thursdays, I would write out my homilies. And then on Friday is the day you're supposed to practice. Yes, they're supposed to practice. On Friday is the day you practice so that on Saturday you're ready for the vigil mass. Well, I'll never forget, you know, when I was doing my diaconate internship, Bishop Dominic Carmen, a phenomenal man of faith, was my pastor. And Bishop Carmen asked me one weekend in August if I was ready to preach at the 4 o'clock vigil mass on Saturday. And I got to tell y'all, though, yeah, I was a little nervous about preaching and stuff like that, but I wasn't nervous about the preaching part. This was just going to be my first time with this particular congregation. So I said, oh, yeah, Bishop, I think I could do that. And so I can tell you that I was so excited. On Monday, I read the readings. Good stuff. Good stuff. Y'all know, I always laugh when people talk about how they were bored in church. I don't know how you can be bored in church. I have never, ever been to a boring church in my life. Now, I have been to church with some boring people, but that's another story. But you can't say church is boring. The word of God that we read have been feeding people over 4,000 years. If you listen to those readings, you let them come to life for you. So you can't say it's boring. So you know, on Monday, I read the readings. Then on Tuesday, I started checking out all the biblical commentaries. And then on Wednesday, the day I was supposed to jot down my ideas, I had nothing. On Thursday, the day you're supposed to, you know, write it all out, I still had nothing. On Friday, the day I'm supposed to practice, I had nothing. On Saturday morning, the day I'm supposed to preach, still nothing. Well, I don't know if y'all understand the panic that will come over a seminarian, a deacon, or a priest's mind when he knows he's supposed to preach at the 4 o'clock vigil mass and it's 11 o'clock on Saturday morning and you have nothing. So in my panic, I decided to pray. And I looked up to heaven. I was like, Lord, all week long, I've been trying to write this homily / reflection because I wasn't ordained yet. And so all week long, I've been trying to write it, but I have nothing. So at 4 o'clock today, you've got a homily to give. What you gonna say? And believe it or not, this is what came out. While waiting outside of church one day, I overheard a mother of the church turn to a boy and say, boy, you better get back home and do something about your hair. Because looking like that, they're not going to let you in there. Then seizing the opportunity, she looked him up and down and started to tell him how to dress while visiting this side of town. You better change that shirt and shine them shoes. And all them colors you got on just makes me confused. You got to straighten up your back. But bend your knees when you pray, because that's the only way you could hear what God's got to say. And while I'm telling you all the stuff that you got to do, you better practice holding your Bible like this and your holy rosary too. Now, once you get all cleaned up and you then practice all you can, come on back to our church so you can be a real praying man. But after hearing that church mother talk and taking in all her stuff, that boy raised his hands to God and said, Lord, enough is enough. He prayed, Heavenly Father, I've done all I can do. I go to church most every Sunday and I try to say what's true. But the folks in the church, they seem to be so worried about my looks, they done forgot about the love they read in their own holy books. They're so worried about my outside, my hair, my clothes, my skin, that they'll never ever get to see the spirit I hold within. So Father, I give them to you to do with what you please. And maybe while they're in there praying on bended knees, they'll think about your words and their souls will begin to see. Most people pay you lip service when their hearts are far from thee. And when he finished praying, that mama, that lady looked all about. And she saw that boy's mama coming. So that church mother began to shout, girl, come get this boy and wash his hair and clean him up just right. Then maybe he could come to our church for the service on Saturday night. But till he's looking better, he better not come here again. Because this is the house of the Lord and not everybody's getting in. But that mama looked at that church mother as she blocked the church's doorway. And with a soft voice and tear-filled eyes, that mama began to pray. I've got shoes, you've got shoes, all of God's children got shoes to wear. When I get to heaven, gonna put on my shoes, walk all over God's heaven, heaven, heaven. Everybody talking about heaven ain't going there. Heaven, heaven, gonna walk all over God's heaven. Then she looked down at her son and she said, Jesus, let's go home. You know what I've come to realize in life? Since we don't know the time, the place, nor the hour when the master will return, better that we treat every child as if he or she is the Christ come back again than to be standing at the judgment seat and find out you treated Jesus as if he or she was nobody. Because you see, the one thing that I'm convinced is that if we stay true to who God calls us to be, not only are we going to be saints in heaven, but ultimately, we must convince our children that they will be with us too. We need to convince them that one day they're going to put on a robe, they're going to put on some new shoes, and they definitely will wear a crown. Fellas, y'all want to help me out? When it's all over. Come on, come on. You know, I can tell you that if you begin to see your children the way I see my boys, you don't have to ask what you need to be doing in Catholic education. If you begin to see them the way I see them, that's why I'm trying not to look because I cry easy. But our job is to help them know who they are. Our vocation from God, the vow that you made to the Lord the moment he knit you in your mother's womb, to help them see who they are. And then to challenge them to follow in the footpath that God has laid out for them. But you got to see, so many people are trying to convince them that they're not destined for greatness. But I've told them before, our whole mantra is going to be real simple. I know my robe is going to fit me well. Because I tried it on at the gates of hell. I know my crown will fit me well. Because I tried it on at the gates of hell. I know my shoes are going to fit me well. Because I tried them on at the gates of hell. If you can walk through the trauma and the stuff that happens in this world, when you get to heaven, you better dance and party like never before. You better shout like never before. But you see, we got to know as educators that there will be times when God will send us such great blessings and we miss the moment because we're so caught up in who we are as the administrators, as the teachers, as the school presidents. It's supposed to be about us. No, it's not. It's about that little snotty-nosed three-year-old coming into your pre-K. It's about that just trying to find herself fourth grader with the attitude. It's about that high school young man who is trying to migrate his way between who he is and how God made him. It's about that high school senior who's so scared to graduate because for the last 13 years of his life, the only time he got to eat a full meal was at breakfast and at lunch at school. See, if we stop thinking that it's about us and we realize who it's really about, then we can be who God needs us to be. See, if you want to know what Catholic identity is all about in our schools, it ain't about all the different stipulations and all the criterias and all the things that, you know, the national office sends us. We got to follow this one and 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 this one. And this. Are you teaching the children who they are? Are you instilling them that wherever they walk, walk with their head up high? That wherever they go, hold your head up high, because if you drop your head, your crown just might fall off. When they walk in the room, do they feel like they own the room? Like they, God gave them dominion over the earth? That little three-year-old should think he runs the place. Sometimes they do. But see, we need to know who we are. Because see, there were times even in sacred scripture when Jesus had a chance to be in the presence with folk and they didn't even know who he was. They had no idea. In fact, in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 41 to 52, I'm going to share the story with y'all. In fact, we Catholics, so the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to our brother Luke. Each year, his parents went to Jerusalem for the feast of Passover. And when he was 12 years old, he went up according to the festival customs. After they had completed the days, as they were returning, the boy Jesus remained behind in Jerusalem. But his parents did not know it. Thinking that he was in the caravan, they journeyed for a day and looked for him among their relatives and acquaintances. But not finding him, they returned to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers and listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were astounded at his understandings and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been looking for you with great anxiety." And he said to them, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he said to them. He went down with them to Nazareth and was obedient to them. And his mother kept all these things in her heart. And Jesus advanced in wisdom and age and favor before God and man. The gospel of the Lord. You know, what I love about that gospel reading is we hear so much and we learn so much about the Holy Family. First, you find out that the Holy Family really was a holy family. They knew that in raising Jesus, he needed to understand who he was as a member of a people of faith. So not only did they pray at home, but they made sure that he went to the synagogue. And then on big events, they would travel to Jerusalem to go to the temple so that he could understand that he was a part of this grand church, that it wasn't just our little home church, but that we were part of something even greater than what you could see in Nazareth. And so when they would travel, they would have these great experiences. But you find out that although they were the holy family, they were not a perfect family. Oh, how could you say that, you know, having Mary and Joseph as your mother and father, truly, it has to be a perfect family? Nah. Because if they were perfect, somebody explain to me, how is it possible that you could travel for a day and not know where your 12-year-old boy was? Oh, you can pretend y'all perfect, but y'all ain't perfect. And so when Mary and Joseph were traveling, my guess, you know, is the reason why they didn't know where he was is because the Bible says they were traveling in a caravan. That's not a minivan. It's a caravan. And it means that they had animals all lined up and, you know, the women were riding on the animals and the men would walk on the side and, you know, and the children would be running along in the back or on the side. And I'm guessing that Mary and Joseph had to be in the front. Well, it's simple because every time you see Mary and Joseph, Joseph got the lantern. He was the headlight. So he had to be in the front. And so as they traveled along, as they were traveling, you know, Mary looked at Joseph. She said, "Hey, Joe, you seen the boy?" And he was like, "Girl, he's your kid. Why you asking me?" I mean, no, Mary, I don't know. So she was like, she's like, "Joe, like, we need to go look for him." And so they headed and they went to the family members to say, "Have you seen little Jesus?" You know, they went to Elizabeth, they said, "Liz, you seen little Jesus?" She said, "No, baby, I haven't." She said, "Well, look, go back and ask John the Baptist." And so they headed back to where the children were, and there was John, you know, you can't miss him, you know, wild hair, camel hair clothes, you know, eating a grasshopper, you know who he was. And so she was like, you know, she said, "John, have you seen little Jesus?" And John's like, "Why are you asking me? I got 18 years before I have to tell you where he is." And so they're like, "Oh my God, I think we left him in Jerusalem." And so if they had been traveling for about a day and a half, it probably took them another day and a half to get back. Because they didn't have like an interstate to take to get a shortcut. So they had to go back the same route. And my guess is by the time Mary got to the gates of Jerusalem, she had to be frantic, thinking that her baby could be inside. But let me make it even more complicated for you. What probably was going through Mary's mind was the fact that not only was her 12-year-old son lost in the metropolitan city, but he was lost in a city where only 10 years earlier, they were still trying to kill him. So now imagine what was going through Mary's heart. By the time she got to the gates of Jerusalem, she was frantic. And she said to Joseph, she said, "Joseph, we got to find our boy. My baby could be laying behind one of these buildings and crying out for me. My baby could be hurting in a gutter and looking for me. My baby could be dead and I never find him. Help me find my child." And Joseph said, "Well, honey, you go this way. I'm going to go this way. We're going to meet up in the middle." And they ran from shop to shop, from market to market. And they were going from place to place saying, "Have you seen him? His name is Jesus. He's this big, long hair, light on the back of his head. You can't miss him." And when they got to the center, Joseph was like, "Honey, I didn't see him." She said, "Joseph, I don't know what we're going to do." He said, "Baby, I don't know either." She said, "Joseph, I know what we have to do. We have to go to the temple." And I don't think she said, "Let's go to the temple," because she thought that's where Jesus was. She said, "Let's go to the temple because we haven't put finding him into the hands of God. Let's go to the temple and ask our Heavenly Father to help us find our baby." And when they got to the temple, back then, the temple used to be divided by sex. So the women would go behind an iron grate on the side, and the men would go into the main body of the church towards the Holy of Holies. And I could see Joseph heading into the men's section and Mary going into the women's section. And Mary dropping on her knees and praying from the depth of her soul, saying, "Heavenly Father, you promised me. If I said yes to that angel, my baby would be the savior of the world. You promised me if I said yes to that angel, my baby would be the fulfillment of all the promises of Abraham. You promised me if I said yes to that angel, no harm would come to my baby's head. You know where my baby is. Find him for me." And it was in the depth of her agony that she heard the voice of Jesus coming from the front of that temple. And then I could see Mary getting up, walking out the women's section and straight through the door of the men's section. And you could see that old man standing at the door saying, no, you must not come in here. And that's when you found out who Mary really was. Because she gave that man the mama look. The look that said, if you don't move, there'll be a funeral here tomorrow. So you can see the man backing up and Mary going into the middle of that church. And as she headed down to the center aisle of that temple, there he was. Sweet little Jesus boy. And she looked at him and she said, son, why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been searching for you with great anxiety. And he looked up at her and he said, why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house? Well, the Bible don't tell us what she said to that boy next. Don't know if you can write them words in sacred scripture. But I'm thinking it was, get your stuff and get it on the caravan. And I'm going to tell you when it's your time. And why do we know it's true? Because when do you hear from him again? When he's 30. When his mama says, son, they're out of wine. And he says, woman, what business of yours is that of mine? I'm going to tell you right now, let me call my mama woman one time. But then his mama, once again, the Bible don't say what she said to him. She turned to the waiter and said, now do what he tells you to do. In other words, remember when he was in that temple? Do something. And Jesus like, mama say do something. Fill up the jugs. His first miracle happened because his mama said do something. Just a little side note. That's why I love our church. And our understanding of Mariology. The fact of the matter is, I believe that we can ask Mary to pray for us because Jesus don't never tell his mama no. And so, when you listen to that story, you get so caught up in all the imagery of the folk in the temple. But do y'all realize that there's a group of folk that we miss? Do you know the scripture said that when they found him, he was standing in the temple, speaking to the teachers and the elders, astounding them with his answers and understanding. But did it hit you that although those men maybe have seen that little boy before, they had no idea who he really was. They had no idea who he really was. Because do you really believe that if they knew that this was Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God, they would have ever let Mary and Joseph take him out that temple? They had no idea who that little boy was. Which is why I live by a very simple mantra. Better that you treat every child of God as if he or she is the Christ come back again than to be standing at the judgment seat and find out you treated Jesus as if he or she was nobody. Because, you know, my mama used to say, the day is going to come when you're going to have to account for how you made your vows and how you fulfilled them. You're going to have to account for the way you treated people on this earth. She said that when you get to the judgment seat, you're going to be naked before God. And all you're going to have is your soul and your life. And she said, when you stand before God, God's going to ask you one question. The same question that he asked to Simon Peter at the end of the Gospel of John. Do you love me? And you're going to be like, yes, Lord. You know that I love you. And then he's going to say, well, let me check the list. When I was hungry, did you give me to eat? When I was thirsty, did you give me to drink? When I was naked, did you bring me clothing? When I was sick or in the hospital, did you come to see me? When I was in prison, did you come visit me? And y'all gonna get all excited. Y'all be like, got this, Catholic school teacher. When you was hungry, I paid for you to get extra fries at lunch. When you was thirsty, we collected water bottles for y'all. When you was naked, winter coats. When you were sick or in the hospital, we did get well cards. We signed them and I brought them to you. When you was in prison, I came and got you out the principal's office. I got this. But then he's going to hit you with the hard question. He's going to say, but when I came to you, did you recognize me? And you're going to look up and say, but Lord, when did you come to me? Then he's going to point to a door. When that door opens, the kid that you least expected to be the Christ will walk through that door. And when you look up, all you're going to say is, oh, not you. It couldn't have been you. Not the one that got on my ever-loving last nerves. Not you. Not the one that made me go home and do more than just Tylenol. Not you. And then he's going to walk up and he's going to be real simple. All he's going to say is, do you see me now? Do you see me now? Because when I needed you to see me, you didn't. When I needed you to tell me who I was, you didn't. When I needed you to take me by my hands and lead me along the ways of God, instead of holding my hand, you decided to just nail them to a tree. When I needed you to tell me that God had put me on this earth and he gave me dominion over the earth, and that everywhere I walk was made for me. Instead of telling me about my dominion, you just decided to nail my feet to a tree. When I needed to know that when I get to heaven, I'm going to put on a crown and walk all over God's heaven. Instead of telling me about my crown of gold, you decided to just crown me with those thorns. When I needed you to know that I had been hurt by so many adults in my life that I built a shell around my heart trying to protect it. Instead of trying to come through the shell, you just chose to pierce me in my side. But today, you ought to thank the Father that I'm not you. So come and inherit the kingdom that I've prepared for you since the foundation of the world. And it will be the kid that you least expected to be the Christ that will walk you into paradise. Better that you treat every child as if he or she is the Christ come back again than to be standing at the judgment seat and find out you treated Jesus as if he or she was nobody. Because you see, we are all destined for greatness. When I was little, I never knew who I was going to be. All truth be told, I never could have imagined that I'd be a priest, able to stand up in front of thousands of people and proclaim the good news. Do you know that when I was young, I was probably one of the shyest kids on the face of this earth? I was so scared to be in front of people. To this day, when my daddy watches videos of stuff I've done around the world, he cries because he says, that's not the little boy that I remember. I was a kid that went to family parties and held on to his mama's leg because he was scared of his own family. Of course, if y'all met my family, you'd understand. In fourth grade, when we had the fourth grade play, all I wanted to be was the tree. Because the tree just stood up in the back and held up a tree. But it was St. Augustine High School that changed me. When I walked into the school, I was one of the littlest ones in the school. I was so little, I wore a size 3 1/2 shoe in 9th grade. And when I walked in and I saw these big giant trees walking around, state champions in football, state champions in basketball, these big old giant dudes, and I was so scared. But what God did was he blessed me because he knew I wanted to be a part of our band. The St. Augustine Marching 100 is a phenomenal band, having played for 7 U.S. presidents, played for all of the major events, Super Bowls, been featured in movies. They even played for Pope John Paul II. I can tell you that I wanted to be a part of that band. And so when I joined the band, my mama was like, but baby, how are you going to be in front of 68,000 people in a Superdome when you're scared to be in front of people at home? But in my mind, I kept thinking, but if I join the band, they won't be looking at me. They're going to be looking at the band. And so when I joined the band, I started to get comfortable with being in front of people, to the point that that little bitty scared 9th grader, by the time he was a senior, I thought the band was there to back me up, and everybody was there to see me. But it was because of that band, because of the education that the Society of St. Joseph of the Sacred Heart, the Josephites, began to provide, that I began to understand who I was, and that I walked out ever confident. By the time I graduated from the university, I knew I was going to be great. I was named the outstanding new teacher in all these parish public schools because I knew I was that good. But I also knew that there was something different. And that's how I ended up saying, maybe I need to give this priesthood a chance. Because maybe there were gifts that God had given me that he could use even greater than as a 3rd grade teacher. Well, I could tell you, that is because the foundation that was laid in me, that not only was Catholic identity important, but who I was as a child of God was important. From kindergarten at Our Lady of Lourdes, through high school at St. Augustine High School, Loyola University, Xavier University, Notre Dame Seminary, all of my Catholic schools helped to instill in me that when I get to heaven, I'm gonna put on a crown and walk all over God's heaven. And that's why when I come in front of folk, sometimes y'all don't understand when I tell you, you should be honored to be in my presence. Because I know I'm going to be a saint. Because if I don't become a saint, it means I have broken my vows before the Lord. You ought to be convincing your children that when they get to heaven, they're going to put on a crown. You know, one of the greatest people that ever influenced my life was my mama. And, you know, I had a mama that was just like me, which is why when I go to meetings, people, I tell them, you want my daddy to come out me, not my mama. Because my mama had a way of saying stuff that I could really understand. And I'll never forget when we were little, every time we left home, my mama would always say the same thing. She would say, before you walk out this door, remember who you belong to and don't be stupid. Remember who you belong to and don't be stupid. And when my friends would hear my mama say, remember who you belong to, we know what they meant. They're like, what? She was saying that when you walk out this door, you represent me wherever you go. What you say, what you do, be it good or bad, you represent me. And we knew that we had better represent her well. Because if we didn't, by the time we got home, it was going to be ugly. In fact, one day, I know we were cutting up, and when we were heading home, one of them no good, messy, always up in your business neighbors called my mama. And we got to the front of the house. My mama was standing on the front porch waiting for us, like Clint Eastwood. And when we walked up, my mama was like, where have you been? We're like, huh? She's like, what have you done? We're like, nothing. And then we got time out. And in my family, time out was, and whatever amount of time you was on that ground, that's your time out. So we never wanted to face my mama. When she said, remember who you belong to, you better remember who you were. But when she would say, don't be stupid, my friends were like, did your mom just call you stupid? You're like, no. She said, don't be stupid. But this is why. See, she taught us that ignorance is when you don't know something. Stupidity is when you know it's wrong, but you still do it. You ain't ignorant, you just stupid. And it's always funny because when I talk about don't be stupid, there's always some well-good-meaning person who's going to come up to me, she's probably from the valley, and she's going to say, you know, Father, in our home, stupid is a bad word. And I'm like, that's how you end up with stupid kids. Because you're scared to tell them what they need to hear in a way they're going to understand it. Because you see, what I realized was my mama summed up for us everything sacred scripture said when she said, remember who you belong to and don't be stupid. She summed up for us everything that that Catholic Church has been teaching when she said, remember who you belong to and don't be stupid. Because why was the Hebrew scriptures, the Old Testament, written? To remind us that we were the children of God. And that every time we did something stupid, we ended up in trouble. He flooded the earth, exiled by the Babylonians. He didn't even say, you know, by the waters of Babylon, we wept. Yep, because stupid people are supposed to cry. But she was telling us that we belong to God. And that no matter where we go, no matter what we do, you better represent him well. And what was don't be stupid is simple. We all know that the New Testament was written because Jesus came to save a world filled with stupid people. Because what would the church say? Stupidity. My mama said, you know it's wrong, but you still do it. The church got a word equivalent. Grave matter. You have full knowledge of what you're doing, and you do it of your own free will. Sin. My mama would just say, stupid. And so, as I conclude, I share with you the wisdom of my mama. When you walk out these doors, no matter where you go, no matter what you do, remember who you belong to and don't be stupid. Remember that you are a child of God and that you represent our Heavenly Father wherever you go, and just don't be stupid. And as I conclude, I do need to say on behalf of all of the vendors that are in the St. Charles Grand Ballroom upstairs, you know, we've been exiled to the third floor. We invite y'all to come see us too, because they got a lot of good stuff down here, but don't miss St. Charles Room, because they got vendors up there that got some good stuff. And at booth 117, you can come see me, where we have all of my books, a lot of products, and we have a lot of things that say, don't be stupid. In fact, we got don't be stupid wristbands. And the wristbands, they only cost $2 because it's cheap enough to get one for you and all your stupid friends. But you should know that I started writing books right after Hurricane Katrina. Because there was a grandmama who came to me and said, Father, I don't know how I'm going to recover from the storm. I had 8 feet of water in my house, fighting FEMA, fighting the insurance company. And then we have to fight to come back. She said, I don't know how I'm going to keep my grandbaby in Catholic schools. And I said, Ms. Nelda, I don't know what we're going to do. But between you, me, and Jesus, we're going to figure something out. That's when I wrote the first book. 12 books later, we're still providing scholarships to Catholic schools. So you see, 100% of the proceeds from my book sales, although I'm a diocesan priest and I can keep it for myself, 100% have been going to support Catholic schools. Since Hurricane Katrina, I'm now blessed to have donated more than $200,000 to the Catholic schools of New Orleans. And so we invite y'all to come up and check us out. My boys will be all around today because they don't want to go back to school. And so But we invite you to come up and see. And I promise you that, you know, with my books, you got to pay for the book, but the autograph is free. My brothers and sisters, my challenge to you is so simple. Remember who you belong to when you walk through the doors of your school. Remember who you belong to when you walk into your classrooms. Remember who you belong to. But don't think you're the only one who belongs to God. Never take for granted that Jesus the Christ just might be sitting in your classroom. May God strengthen you. May God give you faith. And may the prayers of our Blessed Mother help you to be like my mama and teach children in such a way that they will never forget that they were destined for greatness. As we conclude, we have one last song as I'm leaving y'all that I ask our boys to sing. The young men that are directing our choirs are both graduates of our school. We got one 2005 on the piano, Mr. Devin Bukri. One directing, class of 2014, Mr. Cameron Williams. I happen to be in the class of 1982, way older than them. But Mr. Bukri has an ability to take what has been ancient and bring it fresh and new. And so after I offer you a final blessing, they're going to share with you Immaculate Mary in a new and fresh way. And the Lord be with you. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessings. Good and gracious God, we call your spirit down upon these, your sons and your daughters. And we ask you, Lord, to infuse them with the power of the Holy Spirit that helped all of our elders to walk through a journey of faith. Help them to go from this camp meeting, from this hush harbor, destined to bring the power of your love to all the children of the world. May they realize who they are so that they can teach the children that when they get to heaven, they're going to wear a crown. May you be the Blessed Mother to your babies. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.
Oh, is it on? It's on. All right. Say, Ave, 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 Maria. Say, Ave, Ave, Ave.
All right, Josh, bring it. Josh, bring it. Do your thing.
Immaculate Mary, your praises we sing. You reign not in splendor with Jesus, our King. Say Ave,
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 Ave.
Maria, predestined for Christ by eternal decree. God willed you, both Virgin Mother, to be. Say Ave,
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 Maria.